show fly our official carrier, American Airlines. American flies to over 270 destinations in 45 countries. American Airlines, something special in the air.
Tune in tonight at 7:30 for ATV's Melrose Place.
I said I want you to know right now how you know you make me wanna shout. Oh yeah, yeah, shout, hey, yeah, yeah, shout, hey, yeah, yeah.
It may make them wanna shout, but it makes a lot of Maritimers smile. The 1993 Christmas Daddies telethon was a huge success. We'll see some highlights from around the region and find out what it all means to children in need. Tonight, live.
Now, from the ATV News Center at every city and town in the Maritimes, this is the ATV Evening News, live at 5.
Hi, everybody, and welcome to Live at 5 for Monday, December the 6th. I'm Nancy Regan.
And I'm Jonathan Gravener, filling in for Paul Manier, who is still on his way back from Cape Breton after attending the Christmas Daddy celebration up in Sydney yesterday. We're making a walk back, I believe, just to get him back into shape after all the food he ate at the great party. Of course, we'll have more on Christmas Daddies coming up, and also more on Paul Manier a little later and his contributions in Cape Breton.
Here, here. Well, we have a jam-packed show tonight. Here's a look at some of the other stories our ATV reporters are working on.
A moment of silence.
I'm Janice Landry, remembering the Montreal massacre. 4 years later, what steps have been taken to fight violence in society? The story coming up.
I'm Sally Cummings at the St. John Community College, where there have been some major changes in attitudes about violence against women. I'll tell you all about it coming up.
I'm Greg Boone at Transition House, a temporary crisis shelter for abused women and their children. The story coming up later on Live at 5.
And the countdown is over. Baby number 200,000 has arrived at the region's largest maternity hospital. And you could say it was a doubly exciting event.
And Paul may be away, but the plays never take a day off. Check out the hot, the cold, the wimpy, the bold, the moments of all sorts from the weekend of sports. The plays of the weekend later on Live at 5.
All this and much more ahead on the Monday edition of Live at 5. Before we get underway, here's Steve Murphy working on the ATV Evening News at 6.
All right, thank you, Nancy. Good afternoon, everyone. A stunning allegation today at the Miller Inquiry that former New Brunswick Premier Richard Hatfield offered a sexually abused boy money for sex. The incident is alleged to have happened more than 20 years ago. The story tonight at 6 o'clock. Also coming up in just under an hour from now, who's the boss? The weekend leadership convention leaves a major split in the core party. They've now got two leaders, two caucuses, and a whole lot of hard feelings. Question is, will New Brunswick's official opposition survive? The story at 6 o'clock.
Take it down into one of the tables, fill it out, pass it off to the table on the left there.
And also tonight, the unemployment line. It's the lineup that never seems to end. The race is on for about 1,000 new jobs in Cape Breton. But, you know, with a 40% unemployment rate, the competition is fierce. Check it out tonight at 6 o'clock. Right now, it's time to check out the weather forecast quickly tonight. Richard Zarowski at the ATV Weather Center. Richard.
Thanks a lot, Steve. And it is turning colder out there. A weak cold front now moving through the region, entrenching us in a northerly outflow. We're looking at temperatures not too bad, anywhere from 0 to about minus 8 tonight. But that wind chill factor is really going to make it feel chilly out there. And I'll tell you all about it coming up in about half an hour, Steve.
That's right. The weather forecast around 5:30. Then at 6 o'clock, all the day's top stories, including Christmas buying. Tis the season to ring up sales. The push is on to get your money. Retailers are working overtime to get you into their stores, but are they having any success? And what kind of bargains are out there for you anyway? We will look at the Christmas rush tonight at the ATV Evening News at 6 o'clock, right after Live at 5 with Nancy and Jonathan. Back to you guys.
Thank you, Steve. First at 5 tonight, looking back and moving on.
One of Canada's worst mass murders took place 4 years ago today. Tonight we'll look at how our attitudes have been changed by the Montreal massacre and go to the front lines in the battle to end violence against women.
But first, ATV's Janice Landry attended a remembrance ceremony today, and she joins us live from Halifax. Janice.
Well, Nancy and Jonathan, people were saying today that it's great to remember, but that we need more action. That as a society, not enough has been done to fight violence since the Montreal massacre 4 years ago.
Sonia Pelletier, 28, was to graduate the next day in mechanical engineering. She was awarded a degree posthumously.
A single red rose to remember each of the 14 young women murdered at L'École Polytechnique 4 years ago today. At Henson College on the Dalhousie University campus, more than 100 men and women come together to remember.
It is not enough to mourn and to remember. We must continue to speak out, to act, to move, and yes, battle for change. A moment of silence.
The day after the massacre, people everywhere were talking about a need for change.
We in this house grieve today, as does every other Canadian. We will never be the same again.
But what has changed since the Montreal massacre? Well, Canada now has tougher gun control legislation with restrictions on gun storage and magazine capacity. And critics also say sentences for offenders are slowly improving.
Several judges, I've noticed over the last several months, have been very highly outraged at the level of violence that victims experience. And they're talking about it more openly in their decisions.
But others say there's still a long way to go.
Yes, be a little more tougher on them, and then likely they won't be doing so much criminal acts.
There's nothing been done as far as I'm concerned, and as far as I'm concerned, it's getting worse rather than better, and you can just take a look at the violence in any town or city now.
Those at today's remembrance ceremony vow to never forget, but to also push for change, for a safer society for women and all people.
And that's sort of the bottom line here, that while we're remembering the 14 women that were killed at L'École Polytechnique, this is an issue that knows no boundaries in society, that affects men, women, and children. Nancy.
Janice, you've got gun control and sentencing. Are there other areas in which people are calling for more change?
Well, people today were calling for more funding for crisis centers and transition homes so that whoever's in a dangerous situation can have somewhere to go so that they're not feeling alone.
All right, we have a story on just that subject in just a moment. Thank you, Janice.
You're welcome.
That's ATV's Janice Landry in Halifax tonight. Jonathan. It's okay, we're having a little trouble with the camera, and here's Jonathan now.
Thanks, Nancy. Not only have there been some changes in the laws over the past 4 years, but there have also been some improvements in attitudes. Now, many organizations have used the Montreal massacre as a catalyst to address violence against women. ATV Sally Cummings is standing by live in St. John. Now, Sally, you visited one place today. Were there any noticeable changes in the way women are viewed?
Yes, I was at the St. John Community College today, Jonathan, where traditionally there were certain courses that women just didn't take. But now it seems that men and women sit side by side in most every class, and there is a marked change in attitudes there.
I felt threatened, and he would always threaten me and threaten that he would take my daughter away, and that is why I stay there. And I finally get the nerve to leave.
After gaining the courage to leave an abusive relationship, Ronaldo Laird is proud of being one of the only women in her electronic technicians course. As modern occupations cross gender lines, attitudes towards women are beginning to improve.
There's been a noticeable change in attitudes here at the St. John Community College in the last 4 years.
I've seen a couple girls in the mechanics course, and there's girls in the construction course.
And you never used to see that before?
No. They weren't allowed to do construction, I guess.
Before, I could say from experience that women and men used to be separate in what they did. And
think there's more respect?
Yeah, everybody's treated equal. So.
That a man can get more time in jail for shooting a deer than he can for hurting his wife.
Organizers were overwhelmed by the response to a forum on violence against women at the college this morning. Over 170 students voluntarily participated in the panel discussion.
To see the room filled and also, you know, the percentage of men in the room. Yeah, it's very encouraging, and I thought they were a very enthusiastic audience and very open, and we're really listening to what people were saying.
School counselors are seeing new interest on the issue.
Last year, I had a couple of students come to me, and they were men who were abusers, and they're in the, it was just shocked me.
Or lewd comments and catcalling going towards the women, and the result was that it was wrong, and I knew it was wrong, but the fact is that I didn't want to be by myself. I wanted to be with the rest of the crowd.
Many male students felt forums like this will help improve their relationships with women.
Now, today's forum helps students put a name and face on many community support programs for violence against women. It also gave them an opportunity to get some questions, to get some answers to some of the questions that they may not normally ask.
But Sally, aren't women still basically in the minority in many of these so-called male courses at our community colleges?
Well, if you'll notice, it's still mostly mature women who are taking some of these non-traditional trade programs. They're women who've already been in the workforce and have a family to support. Now, the principal of the St. John Community College I spoke with today said that what's needed is education beginning earlier, like in elementary school, to get women thinking in these kind of trades.
Thanks, Sally. Still taking an awfully long time to make things change.
That's right.
Back to Nancy.
Thank you, Jonathan. It's estimated that 1 million Canadian women are beaten or abused every year. These abusive relationships are a disturbing fact of life, but in response to the violence, there are support systems in place to help the abused. Janice Landry mentioned it a moment ago. Here's ATV's Greg Boone with more.
Oh, it's my fault, is it? My fault? I'll show you my fault. This is my fault. Now clean that up, you fat slob.
Abuse is frightening, stressful, and often violent. And when a woman finally decides she's had enough, there are places to turn. Crisis shelters play a key role in helping an abused woman make the first step to safety.
It's been 8 years since I got out of my first relationship, and now I'm back into kind of a similar thing. And today I feel comfortable to come in again, and I don't feel embarrassed by coming here.
It's absolutely necessary that we continue talking about violence in families and about the service that's being offered so that women are able to reach out. And yes, attitudes certainly have changed, and people are much more supportive of the issue and certainly of our services.
Maritime shelters are numerous. In Sydney, there's Transition House.
But I mean, it's a home, right?
Oh, yes. They put great plans to make sure that the people who are living here
It's a facility that can house up to 20 women and children, and it's usually filled to capacity. The shelter offers a safe, home-like atmosphere. Various communities also have 24-hour crisis lines and education programs for police officers and adolescent students.
The federal government has also recently recognized the need to assist women after they leave the crisis shelter.
Funding's been made available for what's called second-stage housing in the Glace Bay area. Women who've left the temporary crisis shelter can move into independent living units where they can begin a new life without abuse. Crisis shelter workers say it takes courage to leave an abusive relationship, and women should know that help in most communities is only a phone call away. In Sydney, Greg Boone, ATV News.
Thank you, Greg. Very sad anniversary. You know, I guess there's bad news and good news. The bad news, as Janice said, is that there are still a lot of concrete changes that need to be made. But if attitudes are changing, those concrete changes will come soon, and that's good news if attitudes, particularly among men, are changing.
Yeah, I think that's the key, is education amongst men, because you see the stories we do over and over on more facilities needed for battered women. It'll be a nice day when they finally start closing down some of these shelters because they're not needed. Still ahead on Live at 5, Maritimers come through again big time. The annual Christmas Daddies Telethon was a roaring success this weekend. Now we're going to show you what happens with the money raised.
And we'll take a trip around the region for telethon highlights when Live at 5 returns.
You know, your junior high has been giving money to Christmas Daddies since probably before you guys were going to Gatesbrook, right? So how much money have you got for the plunger this year?
$3,000.
$3,000. There it is, ladies and gentlemen. From the students of Gatesbrook Junior High, who's going to take the plunger?
Need a great gift idea for someone on your list?
Hot eats, cool treats at Dairy Queen.
Introducing Dairy Queen's $1 gift certificate. Buy as many as you need for all those special people. It's an easy way to find something for anyone. Dairy Queen gift certificate. A great gift idea and a great gift to receive.
Hot eats. Cool treats, we treat you right.
Introducing the all-new 1994 Sonoma.
We've packed everything we know into this one. Sonoma, only from GMC Truck.
When flu-related nausea strikes, many children simply can't swallow pills. That's why there are Gravol chewable tablets for children. No liquids, just effective relief from nausea. Trust Gravol. Ask your pharmacist.
Is gambling making life difficult? To stop gambling, call 1-800-461-1234.
If you or someone you know has a problem with gambling, call 1-800-461-1234.
It's nice to be cared for at Christmas. As always, nurses are there when you need them. Merry Christmas and Happy New Year from the New Brunswick Nurses Union.
Make the darkness bright. Only you.
Of Lee and Martin.
I remember when. That song was from the 6th annual Christmas Daddies Telethon back in 69. It still sends out a message that still holds true. Only you could make the difference.
Some great shots from over the years on Christmas Daddies, and Maritimers continue to make the difference in the lives of thousands of children.
Yeah, the 1993 edition of Christmas Daddies Telethon was a tremendous success again. In just a moment, we'll find out just how that money will be used. But first, let's take a quick look around our region.
Welcome to the 1993 Christmas Daddies Telethon.
I can't imagine a better way to spend your time than to help raise money to make it a great Christmas for children.
I got a big case, a small town blue.
We're back here with some more pledges. I want to thank you all for your great donations this afternoon.
A donation of $3,800 from DeWare Supermarket in Rexton.
858-8888, Celebrity Central, call me, Jimmy the Janitor, right here at the Christmas Daddies with your donation. We'll be waiting for you.
This is the first time you've worked on a telethon.
That's right. And you know what? I'm getting it down, though. The number to call is 492-2929 for the 29th year.
Bill's apron, $600, Dynamo.
Whoa.
Suspenders, $800.
And that is the largest single donation in the history of this telethon, ladies and gentlemen.
I'm Bill Jessamine. It's great to be back home again. This is the 19th time I have been privileged to be associated with the Christmas Daddies Telethon.
And welcome back. We're live now from Sydney, Christmas Daddies, 1993. Paul Meunier here with my lovely wife, Joel Krupp.
And the funny thing is that we rarely work together on television. This is only the second time, in fact. It was last year here at Christmas Daddies that we got to do it. It's kind of a weird feeling, isn't it?
It is kind of a strange feeling. And, you know, I was telling somebody.
We missed each other.
Yeah, we will. They're always nice to each other. And, of course, that's the reason Paul's not with us tonight. He was in Cape Breton, and they are just headed back today. They had a great time, great Cape Breton party. And the telethons all over the region were wonderful. The total was a whopping $721,000. You should give yourselves a hand, because we couldn't do it without you. And I guess that's the message we want to send out now. Now that the telethons are over, we want you to honor your pledge as quickly as possible. That's because what you see on camera on Sunday afternoon is only part of the Christmas Daddies effort. ATV's Jonathan Cade joins us now live from Halifax. Jonathan, what happens to all that money?
Well, as you said, Nancy, the sets and the staging are all put away in storage for another year, and Christmas Daddies show number 29 is over. But really, the work has just begun, because as those pledges are honored now, that money is being sent throughout the Maritimes back to the communities from which it came.
They're rolling pennies and counting until they can't count anymore. Here in the accounting office of the Children's Aid Society in Halifax, people in this office handle all of the donations made to the Halifax Telethon.
What are your folks doing today, now that the telethon's complete?
Well, here at the Children's Aid Society of Halifax, we get all the proceeds from that show. And we're the ones that go through all of that and send those monies back to the areas in the province from which the donations came.
Generally, children who benefit from Christmas Daddies live in households with extremely tight budgets. After the bare necessities are paid for, food, shelter, and basic clothing, there's little left over for extras. Money raised in Sydney is also turned over to the Children's Aid Society, while in Moncton, all money raised in New Brunswick and Prince Edward Island is looked after by the Salvation Army.
We need to pledge as soon as possible because, as we realized, we're already into December month, and we need to get our checks out to the different communities as early as possible, preferably by the 15th of December, if at all possible, so that they can get their shopping done and get treats ready for their Christmas list for their children.
The money helps families buy Christmas extras. Now, we might think extras are frivolous, but the people who work with these families say, in this case, extras are things such as a pair of skates, things that these children might never have without the telethons.
The look on their faces is something else when I go in after Christmas and they say, oh, like a lot of my children, 6 and 7, call me Aunt Bevy. Okay, because I'm in the home so often, and they show me their skates or whatever, and their little faces are just, it makes me feel good, you know, so it is a great help. I don't know what we'd do without it.
So while we in the television business might think the telethon is a lot of work, really, the work has just begun, Nancy, to get that money in and to get it out to the people who need it before Christmas.
Mm-hmm. And what better incentive to honor your pledge, Jonathan?
Well, and don't forget, even if you weren't watching yesterday and didn't call into the show, you can still make a donation at any of the places where people are honoring their pledges.
That's right, and I'll tell you where those places are right now. Thank you, Jonathan. It's ATV's Jonathan Kay in Halifax, and here's how you can honor your pledge. In Nova Scotia, just drop it off at any branch of the Royal Bank. In New Brunswick, again, at any branch of the Royal Bank, or send your check or money order to Christmas Daddies, P.O. Box 278, Moncton, New Brunswick, E1C8K9. Now, this is just for New Brunswick. Christmas Daddies, P.O. Box 278, Moncton, New Brunswick, E1C8K9.
And on Prince Edward Island, send a check or money order to Christmas Daddies, Post Office Box 1648, Summerside, Prince Edward Island, C1N2V5. And once again, we thank you for honoring your pledge.
$721,000.
Amazing.
Isn't that incredible?
Particularly in these tough economic times, you think people are
exactly.
Still willing to give. It's
mm-hmm.
great.
It's wonderful. Well, thank you very much for being part of this great success. Live at 5 continues in just a moment with a look back as the Maritime region marks a solemn 76th anniversary. Stay with us.
Most of the Earth's treasures are found below its surface. Retrieving them takes years of single-minded and rigorous pursuit. The same commitment was applied to the Canadian-built Eagle Vision TSI. Cab-forward design and features like dual airbags and the most interior space in its class reflect an unprecedented collaborative effort in designing a car. You don't have to be an archaeologist to dig one. The Vision from Eagle. The car unearthed.
We all like to feel we've done well. Your child needs you. Take time to show you care.
Something to think about from Partners in Education.
I spent years watching her, tall, chin up, poised, always walk like a lady, she'd say, as we glided across the room laughing, our books perfectly balanced. Mom will be fine. She'll get to her hotel, kick off her heels, and find my surprise in her suitcase. She'll call.
Isotoner's extra cushioning surrounds the foot in comfort to protect what you cherish.
Christmas. I love this.
The scene at Fort Needham in Halifax this morning, where many people turned out to mark the anniversary of the Halifax explosion.
It was 76 years ago today that that huge explosion rocked the city of Halifax, resulting in an outpouring of help from around the world. It was shortly after 9 in the morning on December the 6th, 1917, that the munition ship Mont Blanc collided with the Emo in Halifax Harbor, creating the huge explosion. The blast was heard for several hundred kilometers. Almost 2,000 people died. 10,000 were injured in the explosion, which destroyed two-thirds of the city of Halifax and most of North End Dartmouth. Help poured in from around the world with donations of building supplies, food, clothing. It was the biggest non-atomic explosion that ever occurred. Today, just a handful of survivors of that blast remain.
76th anniversary of the Halifax explosion. Well, we have some much more happy anniversaries to tell you about now. We're looking into our milestone segment for this Monday, the 6th of December. Roy and Margaret Pearl of Grafton, Nova Scotia, celebrated their diamond anniversary yesterday. Their family and friends send the pair all their love on their very special milestone. Mr. and Mrs. Wilfred Teed of Spring Hill mark their 61st anniversary together yesterday. Much love sent from the Teed's 5 children, 12 grandchildren, and 15 great-grandchildren. And to the Pearls and the Teed's, everybody here in the newsroom sends out our best wishes, and all the best to you and yours if you're marking a special milestone in your life today.
You been out driving the highways recently?
Mm-hmm. I'm really very frightened to drive on the highways at this time of year, you know?
Well, you know, it used to be terrible to go between New Brunswick and Nova Scotia, just that two-lane bit. But you know, it was only a week ago that politicians put on a ribbon-cutting and lots of hoopla about opening a section of the new four-lane Trans-Canada Highway, which links New Brunswick and Nova Scotia.
But even if the new highway will someday run all the way through New Brunswick, even if it's a winner, it will leave some losers in its wake. ATV's Ron Shaw has more on that.
Most people don't know where Olac is, but they do know there is a place just a nudge over the New Brunswick border where they can gas up and get a bite to eat. I'm standing on the old two-lane Trans-Canada Highway that runs through Olac. If I tried to stand here a week ago, I'd be dead. Right over here is the new four-lane Trans-Canada Highway. It doesn't run through Olac, and that's the problem. No traffic, no business. Danny Patterson runs a restaurant, and it hurts.
I'm slowed it quite a bit down, but I have a feeling that it'll come back. Right now, with the signage is very poor, and people get on the new highway, and with the excitement of the four-lane, once they get on, they don't feel like turning off again right here.
Over at the Apple stand, it doesn't hurt as much, but it still makes a difference. People can't see the open sign from the new four-laner.
Is it a big drop or a little drop?
Well, it's not really that much this week. Maybe 10%. I don't think it's any more than that right now.
Most businesses here are seasonal and need to be seen by tourists. Still back at the restaurant, the truckers say the arrangement is good and people will get used to it.
Not any more dangerous than the 5,000 bumps that were in the old highway that were tearing our trucks apart day by day. So, I mean, it's easier getting through. If we need fuel, we still know where it is. We can come in and get it.
Pulling off an interchange, it's no different than being in the U.S. or any other part of Canada where you're on a properly controlled access highway. You've got to get off the highway to get to a business anyway.
And Danny Patterson says new signs will help.
Well, Irving has two signs going up now that they got permission from the government to put them up. And just people know now that the big stop's in Olac.
But the story of Olac is going to be repeated in years to come on a much larger scale, over and over again, as the new four-lane crawls toward Quebec. In Olac, Ron Shaw, ATV News.
All right, thank you, Ron, very much. There's lots more still to come on the Monday edition of Live at 5, including just what you need for those Monday blues. Paul's away tonight, but Jonathan's pinch hitting with the plays of the weekend later on Live at 5. Stay with us.
Greco introduces the gigantic half-pound Donair. Lots and lots of Greco's juicy, spicy Donair meat and oodles of our original creamy sweet sauce. The half-pound Donair, now only $4.99. It's the biggest Donair in Grecoville.
The first thing I noticed was her hands. It was their grace that struck me and their never-ending charm. I've given up guessing their every gesture because they constantly surprise me. I'll probably ask for her hand one day, or both for that matter. But for now, I'm happy just keeping them safe and warm.
Isotoner's unique fit surrounds the hand in warmth to protect what you cherish.
People that first come to Subway are a little surprised we don't have sandwiches ready, just fresh bread. That's so you can see your sandwich being made and tell me if you like onions, tomatoes, or even hot peppers. I'm not a mind reader, and there's lots to choose from. If your sandwich looks as good as it tastes, that's because Subway has a training center where experts like Mr. Pilchin teaches the art of making beautiful sandwiches. He calls himself an art teacher. I guess that makes me a sandwich artist.
For more information, visit the sandwich artist at a Subway near you.
Gravity. It's more than a fragrance. It's a force of nature. Gravity for men. You couldn't resist it, even if you tried.
Here is a simple test. Which one of these is New Clancy's Amber Ale? The Amber Ale...
Just about everybody was late for work this morning in the Moncton area because overnight snow fell, as you saw by those pictures.
Quite
that turned into slush and yucky stuff. There were a few fender benders, but no serious accidents. High winds that came along with that snow caused some brief power failures here and there, like at my place last night. It was out for a couple of minutes.
Well, this is a dangerous time of year, you know, with the thermometer hovering around the zero mark and rain. You're looking for black ice all over the place, and I think there's been a lot of it in the Maritimes. Here's Richard with an update on the weather. How's it going to be, Rich?
Well, Nancy and Jonathan, what you're looking at is a weak cold front that's moved through, so the temperatures will be below the freezing mark. And, of course, there's been some melting because the daytime temperatures have been falling and started out above the freezing mark. So as you're driving around, again, Nancy, stress, give yourself a little bit of extra time, drive a little more slowly because the roads can be treacherous out there. And, of course, with that cold front having gone through and the temperatures being below the freezing mark overnight, we can expect to see more of that type of weather. You can see it moving out to the east. In that, we have a weak cold front linked up with a low-pressure disturbance off here to the north. It's moved off to the east of Newfoundland. The area of high pressure now getting a chance to move in, and the flow of air is coming in out of the north. So one tonight will be a rather cold night. Temperatures between -2 and about -8 degrees, but the wind chill factor is going to make it seem a lot colder than that, and the wind's almost due north right now. Good news is that we have a bit of a low-pressure disturbance starting to brew over the Great Lakes. Not good that it's a low, but good that we're going to switch the flow to the southwest, and that'll keep the mercury up for tomorrow and both Wednesday and Thursday as well. If we take a look at a close-up view, you can see some breaks in the cloud over the central areas of New Brunswick. And it's just light cloud pretty much all across the region. Again, typical of an area of high pressure, but what's not typical is that it's so dirty. And by dirty, I mean it's picking up all sorts of moisture because the gulf is still open. So we're looking at lots of clouds, scattered snow flurries, drizzle, some scattered precipitation. Daytime highs today remained on the cold side, -2 to +3. It looks like Fredericton had the warmest temperature. And at +3 degrees, so you can see just marginally above the freezing mark in most areas. And again, that makes things rather treacherous. For tonight, it's going to be windy. Temperatures in New Brunswick, -4 to -7 degrees. Mainland of Nova Scotia will be hovering around the freezing mark. And out to the east behind me here, temperatures between -1 in the highlands of Cape Breton, Sydney area, also to about -2 degrees in northern Nova Scotia and Charlottetown in through Prince Edward Island. So you can see that lots of weather moving in. You're looking at some clearing spots tonight, some scattered snow flurries, and of course, with the temperature hovering around the freezing mark, that makes things sticky and slippery. For the weather picture, as far as the systems go, that low pressure disturbance moving off slowly. You can see the frontal disturbance well off to the east by tomorrow, but that troughing in will keep the cloud, and also that northerly flow will also bring in cloud off the open water. And again, we're looking at that area of high pressure being our weather maker, even though it is a dirty one, for the next 3 or 4 days, right into Friday, before another disturbance starts to move through. Let's take a look at tomorrow's weather. Temperatures below the freezing mark in the north. We're looking at some sunshine in northern New Brunswick. Cloudy conditions pretty much widespread across the map, and scattered snow flurries at most. The wind will be dying down. Temperatures will be between, in New Brunswick, -2 and +1 degree. Again, look for the sunshine. That'll make things feel a little better. Out to the east, Prince Edward Island, Cape Breton Island around 3. Mainland of Nova Scotia for the daytime high hovering around 3 or 4 degrees. Again, we're looking at some sunny breaks, a few breaks here and there. Also, we're looking at cloud and the threat of getting a few scattered snow flurries. But as the wind starts to shift around, you notice these temperatures for the daytime high tomorrow not nearly as cold as they were today. Now, probability of sunshine, 70% for tomorrow. For Wednesday, we bring in another 70%. You can see the same ridge of high pressure hanging in there right through Friday. Late Friday, though, it looks as though a bit of a disturbance starting to move through, and we can expect to see the probability of sunshine falling rather dramatically from that 70%. And again, for tonight and overnight, temperature below the freezing mark, look out for the precipitation, reduced visibilities, and also look out for the black ice. It's treacherous out there. That's your weather forecast. Now here's Nancy.
That's right, Richard. Drive carefully. Thank you very much. Well, today, the Nova Scotia Liquor Commission opened what is believed to be the first self-contained liquor store within a grocery store in Canada. ATV's Tiffany Hussey is standing by with the story and the concerns of some shoppers who think milk and martinis just don't mix. Tiffany, is that right?
Well, that's true, Nancy. Today was the official opening of the liquor boutique in the IGA on Quinpool Road. And while some shoppers thought it was a great idea, others had some concerns.
For many Nova Scotians, it's a first. Most looking forward to the ability to one-stop shop for both groceries and liquor.
It is a convenience. There's no doubt about it. The consumer likes to be able to do all their shopping in the same location.
But the Nova Scotia Liquor Commission is also calming some shoppers' fears that the liquor may be too readily available to the wrong crowd.
We check IDs for any of those that we think are underneath the age of 19, and if so, they're not permitted in the store.
For many Saturday grocery shoppers, they'll be a lot happier to know that while they're picking up their evening's groceries, they can pick up that bottle of wine as well. For many IGA shoppers today, visiting the new liquor boutique was a pleasant surprise, and for others, a concern.
I don't think so, not any more so than any other liquor store. You know, if it's regulated here, then there's no problem.
It's convenient. I've often thought there should be a liquor store in this part of town. The only thing I'm concerned about is the proximity of the two high schools.
I think it's a great idea. It's a lot more convenient. It's a lot like the States, if I'm not mistaken. You can get alcohol in corner stores, so you know, you're shopping, it's the same idea.
It is a concern, yes, because, you know, the kids would be coming here, and, you know, I don't know what kind of... they can buy that thing through somebody else, you know.
We have to do the ID thing and that.
Yeah, but I mean, they won't be buying that thing. They will be asked somebody else, you know, to buy for them.
Meanwhile, Boland's Foods officials, who are leasing the Liquor Commission the space, say they aren't worried about liquor getting into the wrong hands.
We have every confidence in Nova Scotia Liquors Commission to their ability to regulate sale to minors. We are obviously concerned about the sale of alcohol to minors, as we're an active sponsor of programs like the Safe Grad program and so on. So we're very concerned. We've taken every effort to make sure the policies are in place.
Most of the reaction today to the opening of the liquor store was positive, simply because of the convenience of it. In fact, just despite a few customers, they said that liquor wouldn't be any more readily available to minors at this location than at any other location.
Mm-hmm. Are they taking any extra special precautions, Tiffany, because of the proximity of the high schools?
There's not really anything they can do besides the proof of age or ID thing. They do what they do at other liquor stores here, and that's what they're sticking by.
All right. Thank you, Tiffany.
You're welcome.
ATV's Tiffany Hussey in Halifax tonight. Up next on Live at 5, Yvonne Colbert's wading through her mounds of mail. Her Mailbag Monday is just ahead when Live at 5 continues on your side.
In
France, knowing how to live well is a tradition, and the making of the daily bread is a jealously guarded art. From this country, where they know how to draw the best from the vine, we have taken a dry wine that captures all of the qualities of its origins.
Salut Maurice. Ça va Marcel?
Ça va.
Petit rouge?
Le Villageois, red or white wine, imported from France. Le Villageois, as French as good French bread.
Buying the right truck doesn't have to be a puzzling experience, because with Ford F-Series pickups, the puzzle is solved. Let your Atlantic, Ford, and Mercury dealers put all the right pieces together for you, including a special Enforcer package loaded with extras for just $12,994, including driver's side airbag, rear ABS, and power steering. Play to win with F-Series Enforcer, Canada's best-selling full-size pickup and the best truck on the block. But hurry, time is running out.
My daughter thinks I'm a bit wild. She's a little on the conservative side. But when she talked to me about my arthritis pain, I listened. She says a lot of the pain can be caused by inflammation. So I should be taking something specially made for the pain of inflammation. Entrofin. Well, Entrofin really does help me move more freely. The doctor was right.
Entrofin, for the pain of inflammation, so you can move more freely.
Do you have a future in your job? It's estimated that 1,000 new truck drivers will be in demand in Atlantic Canada every year until the year 2000. Now is the time to open the doors to your future with the help of GW Driver Training School. Our certified instructors will teach you the skills necessary to become a professional on the road all year round. The trucking industry needs you now. Call GW Driver Training School today.
You ever thought of moving to Montana and starting a dental floss farm? I know, you think that's strange. Sounds strange.